Welcome to the latest edition of Broadcasting Today. Today we have Benjamin Zand, RTS Young Journalist of the Year, documentary maker and journalist extraordinaire. It's a great pleasure to have him here with us. All part of our mission here at Middlesex University London to teach students how to think, but more importantly, how to do. Welcome to the latest series of Broadcasting Today. And today we've got Benjamin Zand on the stand with an invited audience from Stanmore College. Let's hear it, Stanmore College. And joining me on the podium is Melvis Ohenlen, who's a third year undergraduate, who is going to join me in interviewing Benjamin. Looking forward to it, are you?
Yes, I am,
You're not too nervous?
A little bit, but...
A little bit, yeah. It's all right, you'll settle down.
Gonna let it flow,
you'll settle down, So, first of all, what got you into this bug of being a journalist stroke documentary maker? I mean, I noticed from your biog, you were doing lots of stuff whilst you were still at university, get it up on YouTube.
Yeah, I mean, it's a difficult question, to be honest. It was a long route. I originally wanted to be an astronomer. And then I failed massively. Not an astronomer, I always say this. I wanted to be a, like an astrophysicist type of thing.
And then astrologer, not...
Yeah, exactly. I always mix up astronomer and astrology, and I'm like, no, not an astrologer. But then I failed miserably at physics, which was a blessing in disguise. And then I basically, my Iranian kind of heritage, I was very interested in the Middle East. I luckily kind of came up, well, not luckily, was, you know, going through school and university during the time of kind of major upheaval and unrest in the Middle East and the Arab Spring and stuff. So I got really, really into it at that point. And then I decided, when I was a kid, people always say this, but I kind of always picked up a camera and started trying to film stuff. So I realized this is something that might be of interest for me. So I went to a kind of open day at different journalism courses around the UK and realized that it was... something that was very interesting for me. And then, I started when I was in college making videos in the kind of media department there. And documentaries at that point kind of totally hooked me. I was watching Louis Theroux stuff then and kind of Nick Broomfield and stuff. And it was just amazing purely because for a number of reasons, I've always enjoyed meeting new people. So I was like, this is a job that will allow me to meet not only new people, but people who are doing crazy things, which I would never, ever imagine doing. And I've always been very interested in trying to understand people, and this was an opportunity to do that. And then, to be honest, kind of traveling as well. I wanted to see the world, and this was something that allowed me to see the world.
I'm interested that actually you said that it was your interest which sparked the decision to go to a particular type of university to do a particular type of course.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, no, it was totally. It was what I, as I said, I was very interested in the Middle East. And my dad is an Iranian man who kind of went to Liverpool, decided to kind of abandon his entire culture and stuff. I mean, not in a bad way. He was just, you know, very much a man who wanted to integrate. So I didn't really know what it was like to be Iranian. So to be fair, my Iranianness was something that totally got me into this kind of, a bit into like the investigatory side of it. That's when I started watching documentaries, because I started watching things on Iran and on Iranian history, and then it kind of expanded from there to the Middle East, and I was looking at kind of the Middle East in general and learning about the history of the Middle East. And then once, as I said, the kind of Arab Spring came to be, and that was such a huge event in kind of journalism in the Middle East in general that that totally, just watching people cover those things totally made me realize that, like, that is cool. I want to do that. I want to tell people about the world and show people the world. And luckily, I mean, I can say with 100% confidence to all our beautiful little audience here that journalism is the best career in the entire world. It really is.
That's impressive. So I'm sure that the documentary Terangles was actually something that was stemmed from that, the desire to actually know more about your people and the desire for, you know, the Iranian people.
Yeah, no, that documentary is funny because people always... always bring it up for some reason every time I go to one of these things, and it was the first thing I ever properly made, like I properly invested time in. Now when I look back, it's the worst thing in the entire world. It's called Tarangeles. Tehran and Los Angeles kind of merged together. But that was once again purely just because it kind of combined everything. I had heard about, I wanted to make a documentary, and I'd spent a long time talking about making a video. And people weren't making as much stuff on kind of YouTube then and just kind of putting them up. So I wasn't totally in that kind of realm of just making films myself at that point and just kind of throwing them out there. But then, yeah, I was given, I kind of won a grant for the flight. So I won a £500 grant to fly out to Los Angeles. And then I made that, and that documentary totally just made me realise how much I loved it, because I just spent like 2 weeks going around meeting these people, learning about both Iran, learning about like America, learning about how to make films, and just kind of feeling like a somebody for a little bit. And it was nice, it was good. As I said, looking back, it's such a terrible film, it's the least enjoyable thing for me to watch, but it's good to have done it.
What are some of the lessons that you've learnt from that documentary, because it was well presented? So
I don't think it was well presented. No. I learned many lessons, which is that I needed to do a lot of work. I'm very self-critical, but especially with that. I mean, it wasn't meant to be good. It was just, that was like the first thing I properly did. So, I mean, the lesson I've learned from that is that you kind of have to try it. You can't just go from being like, and you know, having no knowledge of how to do something and then suddenly being the greatest person at it whatsoever. You have to literally try every element of it and then slowly progress. And the reason that was good is because, which I still do to this day, I did pretty much everything apart from some film and help from my brother. I did everything. So you learn like every single aspect of how to make a film. And I'm still doing that today, because I've still got a lot to learn. So that's kind of the process, is whatever you do, try and learn every element of it. And then even if you end up just doing one aspect, if you know how everything else works, you'll be so much better at that individual thing.
Of course, it was an opportunity for you to showcase what your capabilities were, wasn't it? And so coming to the BBC with that showcase, how has that transition been a challenge for you?
Been a challenge? I mean, I'm not sure. Do you mean a challenge in terms of how me entering the BBC? Yeah, how exactly. Was it a challenge? Exactly. Well, it was definitely a challenge, just because journalism is such a difficult industry to get into, because, I mean, not too dissimilar from like acting and wanting to be an actress or something. There's just 10 million people who want to do the exact same thing as you, who are all like probably better than you, and they're all kind of fighting for the same type of job. So it was difficult just initially getting my foot in the door. I remember, like, even now to think back, it's such a radical step from being like, when I was in university and when I was in college and stuff, to think of working for the BBC was such an inachievable thing. I'm from like a really, like quite a rough area in Liverpool. Nobody I went to school with, none of my kind of family members or my friends' family members had a career in broadcasting or the media or journalism. I knew nobody. So that was such an insane thought. And it was only kind of from a realization of kind of year on year, you get a bit more experience. I did an insane amount of work experience when I was in university, which is another thing I'd suggest doing, that allowed me to hone in on what I wanted to do. And then that documentary just allowed me to once again narrow, this is exactly what I want to do. I want to get into broadcasting. The BBC is a place I'd like to do. The kind of story behind how I entered the BBC was essentially that I made that documentary, and then the BBC World Service 6 months later made the exact same documentary but on radio. Right. So I was like, they stole my idea. So I kind of got in touch with the person who made it. They said, we didn't steal your idea, but we did kind of use it as inspiration. Uh-huh. And they told me to apply for like this broadcast journalism job. And then I applied. They said no originally. But then they offered me like a 3 week kind of trial or work experience thing. And then I went, and then after a week they gave me shifts so I could start working for it. But it's definitely been a challenge, even just because, as I said, my background, I didn't have anybody to use as like a mentor, because I didn't know anybody else in journalism or in the broadcasting world. So, and there wasn't many Scousers at the BBC. There still isn't. So it was just, it was just a bit of a
shame. I think in the Jewish community, they call that chutzpah, don't they?
Yeah, a bit of chutzpah,
getting out there and putting your face on other people's table, as it were.
Yeah, I mean, it's not an easy thing to do. It really isn't. I mean, I remember I used to go to a lot of kind of networking events. I at the start, I did it all. I kind of knew what I was meant to do, but it was very difficult to do it, because I would go to all these networking events and you have all these like really important people. I went to like the Sheffield Documentary Festival, which is held kind of each year, and it's a really good. You get all these people who are really big in the industry and stuff, and I'd go and I'd be like, okay, I know exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to get to this event, everybody's kind of drinking, I'm just going to walk up to the person that I want a job from, just kind of slap them in the face and say, you're going to give me a job. And then all I'd actually do is stand, like, hypothetically slap in the face. Maybe if it would work. Yeah, and then I'd end up doing was just kind of sitting there alone in the corner, just like really nervous, and like, so I didn't have that much chutzpah. It was just kind of gradual, you know. Yeah, maybe figuring out, maybe as someone's going to the toilet, pretend you just casually bump into them and be like, oh, sorry, just to let you know, I'm Benjamin. So, yeah, there's a lot of strange tactics employed in my kind of way to the BBC, but, yeah, you got to do strange things to be a journalist.
Britain's First, quite a sensitive topic. You see, when you made that documentary, how did you manage to kind of maintain professionalism and, you know, not expressing your opinions?
I mean, you could ask the same with every kind of documentary I make. You always meet people who have completely different views to you. To be fair, in the position of when I am making these documentaries, I do genuinely try to the best of my abilities to just not feel anything or to have any emotion whatsoever. Yeah. So I wasn't angry. I didn't really. What they were saying is a view held by many people or some people. So I mean, they're not crazy. They were just people who had a view. So it wasn't like a kind of moment that I wanted to be angry. I just wanted to find out what they thought.
But so it's quite tough, isn't it, when you're talking to people like that who actually are talking rubbish, and you've got to be serious, and you're trying to have a serious conversation. So you're being serious, and rubbish is coming back the other way. I mean, and they're trying to rile you. You do have to kind of stay in a zone, don't you?
Yeah, I mean, talking rubbish is totally. It depends on who you are and what kind of what life you've lived and the experience you've had. You know, they have a view that is from a specific type of person. And, you know, that view, if it's right or wrong, is for someone else to decide. It's not necessarily for me to decide in that piece. They are just they are just people who believe something, and it was my kind of job to figure out what they believe and why they believe it. And that was literally all I was trying to do. It wasn't. There was nothing beyond that. So the only thing I would get. The only thing I get annoyed about is when someone kind of cuts you off or doesn't let you ask a proper question, because anybody would. So there were certain moments with everybody, not just them, where you're like, you know, why are you interrupting me? I'm giving you the opportunity to talk, so you should give me the opportunity to talk. And also because we were surrounded by a huge amount of people who were kind of all kind of egged on, and they're egging them on to kind of get a bit more loud. But yeah, I mean, I interviewed them. They answered my questions. They did try and stop me from filming halfway through. Which, you know, isn't cool, but they allowed me to interview them at least. So yeah, there are certain situations where it's difficult to keep you cool, but you just got to do it. Yeah. Otherwise, you're gonna not be a very.
Did you get much audience response for that piece on Britain First?
Yeah, huge amount.
I mean, I can remember in the day when I interviewed, you know, whether it be NF officials, National Front officials, or British National Party officials, what would happen was you got a colossal amount of comment on that interview. Compared with an interview you might have done with the Prime Minister.
Yeah, no, totally. It's because that's what they're kind of made up from, isn't it? They touch on the issues that, you know, some people have. So they're hitting the hot points, like, so that, you know, they know why people are angry, and they're choosing to target those specific issues. Which is, to be honest, that's just what politics is. But yeah, what they're doing is very controversial topics. So as a consequence, controversy causes people to comment, because that's what it's all about. You know, it starts conversation. So yeah, there was a huge response, which I wasn't even remotely surprised about. I mean, it's just one of those things. Even the fact that you've brought it up and other people you speak to about it shows that, for some reason, that is an interesting topic. Because it's, you know, racism is always interesting. Not necessarily, you know, whether they're racist or not, but topics around racism, around faith, or around far right, they're always topics that people want to talk about. So that wasn't surprising.
Now, obviously, today we've got an invited audience of students who are just about thinking about their life at university. Perhaps they're not quite gotten to think about life beyond university yet. But one of the things you alluded to earlier was how work experience, getting experience in the workplace, has been critical for you. Explain that.
Yeah, work experience is without a doubt the most important thing, especially in a career like journalism, because journalism is so experience based. For example, nobody in my career has asked me for my journalism degree. Nobody has said, can you show me what degree you have, tell me what grade you got, and that. Not one person. But they have asked me where I've worked before, and they've asked me what films I've made before, they've asked me who I've worked with. So the work experience is useful for so many things. Probably at the beginning, more so just to figure out exactly what it is you want to do in life. I mean, that's such an... A lot of people will say, you know, you don't have to decide what you want to do. But if you want to be successful, you know, reasonably quickly, you do have to have some idea of where you want to go, because otherwise it's like getting into a car with no destination. You'll just kind of be aimlessly driving around. It's, you have to kind of figure out what it is that you want to get to, and work experience allows you to figure out what path you want to follow and figure out what you enjoy, what you don't enjoy. For example, for me, I figured out I really didn't want to work in the print media. It's for some people, it's not for me. I eventually figured out that I like TV a lot more than radio. And then as a consequence, that was like completely what I targeted. It was like, I want to work in television. I want to make documentaries. And as a consequence of realizing what it is that you want to do, you can keep pushing towards it. And you can reject things that you don't want to do. You can move out away from the things you don't want to do. I mean, and don't get me wrong, I mean, even now I'm having a moment where you try and realign. You're like, where exactly should I aim for? But as long as you have a general idea of destination you want to get to, that's a good start.
And the point is that that work experience helps you calibrate 100%. Where it is that you want to be.
Genuinely,
it helps you eliminate things you don't want to do, really.
Like every single work experience I would do would teach me things. Some of them would be the worst things I've ever done. They were so boring, or people were horrible, and they were mostly print media. And I would go and just instantly be like, okay, these are not the topics I want to do. This is not the place I want to work for. This is not the type of media I want to work for. So that's off the list. You know, you kind of have a, yes, this would be interesting list, this is the most boring thing in the world list. You just very firmly smash that into the other one.
Cool. Regarding experience, what advice would you give young people, aspiring journalists, who want to get into that, and, you know, they have a desire to start a project perhaps, but don't have the confidence, that, because you started your own travel website, so what would you advise them?
That's a good question. I mean, the confidence is a very important thing, because what will happen is a lot of people talk about things for a long time. They'll be like, I want to make a documentary. 6 months later, I think I know what I want to make my documentary about. Oh, that's cool. Have you contacted anybody in regards to speaking to them? No, but I know I want to do it, but I just don't have the camera yet. Or I just don't have the kit, or I don't have a producer to work with me, blah, blah, blah. And people will make a lot, and I did the exact same thing. You make a lot of excuses, and you find, like, because you try and aim for the biggest thing possible. You're like, I need to do it with, like, a really expensive camera and with really good guests and, like, with, like, the best producers or something, which is, you know, to be honest, quite unachievable. So what I would actually say is, start off reasonably small in terms of what you're aiming to do, which sounds counterproductive. Be very ambitious in what it's going to be, but just don't stop yourself from kind of developing and growing your craft and your skills because you're trying to just do something that is completely impossible. And don't make excuses. Like, if you actually want to do something, get your camera and just go out today or tomorrow and just go and film something, because just by doing that, even if it's the most boring thing in the world, you will learn something. And also, don't be cocky. I've met a lot of people along the way who are like, well, I should be doing better stuff than that. And it's like, why should you be doing better stuff than that? You have done nothing to this point. To everybody in the journalism world, you are nobody, which is not a bad thing. It just means you have the opportunity to figure out, you know, you have the opportunity to craft your work, but it'll take some time.
So from your point of view, how do you go about choosing the stories you want to work on? Or do you have a little secret list of stories that you're going to be doing in the next 6 months or a year or 2 years, and then the even more secret list of what you're going to be doing next year?
Well, I definitely have a list. I mean, you have to as a journalist. Just kind of what will happen is you'll be having a conversation with someone, and someone will be like, did you know that there's 16 pigs flying to Mars tomorrow? And you're like, what? How is that happening? So you kind of write it down, you remember, you have all these things. That's not a real example, by the way. Pigs did not go to Mars. I think for me, it's just always about interesting people. Honestly, just kind of people. I like people kind of on the fringes of society doing things that you would not expect. I like to show people things. And this is a very broad thing. And the reason I like it is because it can have a bit of humour in it. And I like to do things that people can laugh at a little bit, but that are quite, you know, reasonably serious topics that have kind of meaningful reasons for doing them. I just love meeting people that are radically different to me. And that's why when you said to me in terms of Britain First, like, I actually very much enjoyed meeting them, because I don't think I know everything. I am the way I am due to the kind of life I have lived and the way my parents spoke to me and the experiences I've had. And other people have had completely different upbringings, completely different lives. And even people that you think are crazy, there's a reason for the way that they think, and there's like a motivation behind what they're doing. And most people think that they're good people. So it's trying to figure out why we have such radically different people. And then just kind of, I do like a bit of controversy because it gets people talking. So kind of things to do with racism, religion, sex, kind of all these sin and vice topics are all interesting to do as well. And then I like to travel, so I do travel stuff.
It's interesting, because the reason I raised it earlier with this group of students, that actually they all come from Stanmore, and I wanted to tell them something interesting about Stanmore, because often the stories closest to home are the ones which actually are really on it. I was telling the story about one of the only surviving Auschwitz, who survived the gas chambers of Auschwitz. A woman who's now in her 90s who lives in Stanmore. You wouldn't think of that kind of person on your doorstep, but those people are all around you. So there's always an opportunity just to, as you say, pick up a camera, find the story, go and make the film.
But a good example of that is for like the last 2 years I've been doing like international world news stories. So mostly things that are kind of pointed away from the UK. And then for the last year, I've just been doing UK stories. And obviously the UK is a big place, but originally when I was doing that, I was like, oh, is this going to be as interesting? I don't know if I'm, you know, it's such a smaller place to look at and stuff. And then I've found more interesting stories here because you're in amongst it and you're meeting people every day and that you just, you'd never expect to find. So it goes to show that everybody is very interesting. Everybody has really interesting stories. I used to, like, this is another reason why I got into journalism, because I genuinely, like, every time I'd go on holiday or something, or I'd go to a place I've never been to before, I'd kind of stop and people watch, and I'd look at like every person who walked past me and just think that there's a line from this person to when they were born, and along that line is just crazy stuff. Like, you know, that's so radically different to like the life I have lived, and each kind of step along the way could be a story. Like, everybody has just an infinite amount of tales, and as a journalist you get paid to just investigate this stuff.
It's how cool. Much has social media changed the way in which you approach finding stories and then telling stories, even if your main avenue is documentary TV? Social media can't be ignored, can it, in terms of presenting the story and getting those stories in?
I mean, well, my main avenue is definitely not TV. My main avenue is the internet in terms of documentaries I make. And as a consequence, social media is the place that you get people to kind of watch that stuff. And I mean, yeah, I spend an inordinate amount of time on social media, too much. It has taken over my lives. I wish it didn't exist. But yeah, it's the things that it's done for journalism is just ridiculous. It's completely changed the game. As you said, I'm going to Pakistan in about 2 weeks. I found about three people I'm going to interview just from Twitter, just kind of getting in touch with them, being like, you know, could you possibly, I couldn't find an email for them, couldn't find the Facebook page, which is social media also, but I couldn't find like a phone number for them. So I just tweeted them, they immediately got back to me, set up an interview. So it's changed every aspect of it. There's no going back now. It's not even that it's changed, it's that it is journalism completely. TV is the thing that is going to disappear.
Cool. So what are the main qualities that students should have if they want to get into broadcasting?
A lot of things. You gotta be willing to kind of give up a huge portion of your life to journalism. It's one of those things where you have to very quickly realize if this is something you want to do or not, because journalism isn't something that you can like half ass. You need to properly do it all the time, and it's so overwhelmingly busy that you just do it all the time. You're constantly thinking about things to do, and it kind of gets into every aspect of your life, and every single person you speak to, you're thinking of them like a story, and you spend so much time on social media trying to promote your stuff, and it's just like an entire lifestyle. That the main quality is kind of realizing this is something you want to do, being curious, being able to kind of be patient with things, because people kind of mess you about a lot as a journalist, and you have to be willing. You have to be able to not get angry very easily. That's probably the worst thing to do, is get angry, because you're going to fail miserably. And then, as they always say, curiosity. You've got to be a curious person. You just got to be interested in things and a good listener.
I always remember John Sweeney and his tomato moment.
Is this Scientology?
Scientology, yeah. Go and look it up on Google when you get home. John Sweeney, Scientology, completely loses it. Obviously, he'd been a journalist for many years, so it didn't do him that much harm. he's still practicing, but it did kind of tarnish him a little bit, I think.
Yeah, I mean, even with politicians, if you see a politician just suddenly go crazy and lose it, you just think, how can I now think this person is no longer credible because they're just irrational? So yeah, you have to be, I think that's the thing, you have to be cool, calm, just nice and easy.
Yeah.
Which is hard. A lot of journalists are really awkward for some reason. I don't know why that is. Would you agree with that, do you think?
Yeah, I think particularly print journalists.
Yeah.
I think if you're a performer and you're a television journalist, you have to overcome that. But there's probably a high quotient of Asperger's people in print journalism.
Yeah. Yeah, so I mean,
don't actually like to come face to face with people other than the end of a telephone.
Yeah, I wouldn't necessarily say that was a quality that you should have, but that's what most do have. So maybe that's an advantage.
Cool. So what were the people that you looked up to, people that you admired as a young journalist?
Definitely Louis Theroux and Nick Broomfield, 100%.
Cool.
Louis Theroux just because he's Louis Theroux and just the way he asks questions and because he does serious topics in a slightly kind of funny way and he's a funny dude. Mm. And then Nick Broomfield because it seemed like he was doing everything himself.
Mm.
And he was his is just a completely different style. So yeah, those two. I liked Raghy Omar as well.
Okay.
He did interesting stuff. Now less so because I like to film myself, so kind of the Nick Broomfield thing is still there. But yeah, those guys.
Mm.
What do you take from them, though? I mean, beyond the fact that Nick does all his own, he doesn't do all his own film work, but yes, he's on camera, number one, as a filmmaker, which at that point was unusual.
Mm.
Louis, obviously, is definitely in the mould of the sort of old-fashioned style of, the punter's friend with difficult subjects. What is it that you take from them in terms of how you want to create your craft? Because, of course, you're at the beginning of your career.
Mm-hmm.
You've got 20, 30 years ahead of you.
Yeah. That'd be a very short life.
Short life, but you know what I mean.
I'd say Louis Theroux. I mean, both of them. Louis Theroux, it's just all about the way he asks questions. This is what he's famous for.
Mm.
But I think it's more his style, which is this is what always appealed to me, is that he's doing very, very serious things. But it's not depressing. You are learning about serious topics and about different types of people, but you can enjoy it simultaneously. Mm-hmm. And then I don't necessarily like it when journalists are aggressive and confrontational, because I'm just not that type of guy. And Louis Theroux gets out, he can ask the questions without being aggressive. Mm-hmm. You don't need to be confrontational. That's what I try and do myself. There's just no, for me, I don't like it when someone's shouting at me and you can ask difficult questions in a less aggressive way, I think. So that's what I get from him. Totally.
Do you think there's a pressure on you being young to try and address that younger demographic? I mean, old geezers like me, do stories for older people, and young people like you do stories for that demographic.
There's both a pressure and a blessing in a way. I mean, I enjoy doing stuff for younger people because that's currently what I am. This is the thing that I always do. People will always say, do it for the 18 to 35 demographic or 15 to 35, whatever. So I do those types of topics. But then again, I just think that what I really do is just make things as interesting as I possibly can. And no matter what age you are, you enjoy interesting content. I definitely get the young kind of videos, but I'm happy with it.
One of the things that, we were starting to do here at Middlesex, and it's very important, but people don't think about it, don't think about journalism in this way, is being an entrepreneur. Very traditionally, when I joined the BBC in 1989, people aspired to having a job. And they would talk, I can remember going, starting at the BBC, and they say to me, have you signed up for your pension yet? I'm like, I'm 27, why should I be worried about my pension? That's, a long way ahead. Yeah, but it's really important, you get your pension. That mindset has completely changed, and it has to change, because those jobs are very few and far between. They'll never be completely gone. But the reality is, if you're a performer, you're much more like an actor. Even as a director, you're much more like an actor in that freelance world. Mm. And so you have to be much more entrepreneurial about it.
Which I think actually totally
this generation are instinctively much more entrepreneurial, and they're digital natives, as it were, or millennials, whatever you want to call it. So they think more in that way. How important do you think that is in, keeping in work, basically?
Yeah, I mean, totally. I'm glad you brought it up. I quite often do kind of talks around different universities because I'm young and journalist and stuff. And that's kind of one of the main things I stress, is that you have to sell yourself big time. Like, that is totally what it is. This, I mean, and the most sustainable way to always have a job, in a way, is to have a brand of people to know who you are. So then you will be asked to do work. And yeah, and as you said, with social media, you kind of have a little start point anyway, because you are in your head already crafting kind of the headlines for the pieces that you make. You're trying to sell it as best as you can. You're posting it at the right time. You're thinking about when to post it. You're thinking, if you're good at, you know, the internet, you'll have like a voice, you'll have a type of character and a kind of persona on the internet. So 110%. Like, that's why Twitter to journalists is so important, because they have like an actual follow account in their head, this kind of how successful they are. And on Facebook, you have Facebook likes. So it's totally being an entrepreneur. And especially if you're a freelancer, you are an entrepreneur. You essentially, you know, you're self-employed, you basically are your own business. So it's extremely important.
When we talked about work experience earlier, but in a way, what you're saying is that you've got to be a bit of a juggler, because you've got to try and use those existing institutions like the BBC, like ITV, like Sky, to get some work experience. But at the same time, you've got to be running your own YouTube channel, which sounds daunting, but actually it's not. It's just signing up and creating it, and then putting content on it. That's the more difficult bit, getting the right content. But it might be you've got a, you know, a Gina Turgle, survivor from Auschwitz, living next door to you. Her story can be told, and she might be willing to tell it to you. So you start building up content. So in a way, it's doing both of those things.
Yeah, totally.
And not waiting until you finish university.
Definitely not waiting until you finish university. I mean, the thing is you got to think about the kind of ideal situation in life. The thing is that you want to be doing the things you want to do as early as possible, and the faster you can do them is if you can become successful within yourself. If you have, because the thing is that quite often people get hired nowadays, which probably isn't, you know, some will argue it's not necessarily the right thing to do, but they get hired purely due to the audiences that they have already. So for example, if you're a 19-year-old coming to a media organization and you have 1.3 million followers on like Twitter, you've already got an insane amount of people who want to watch what you make. So that's such a valuable thing to have. And the truth is that, I mean, the kind of organizations and corporations aren't your friend. They're not going to keep you employed forever because they like you. You want to be as sustainable as possible within yourself. And you want to make sure that you as a personal brand can sell things, and that you have a style, and that what you make is enjoyable to people, because then you, no matter what happens, can sell your stuff to anyone, to anywhere, even if, you know, someone at an organisation chooses not to like you or something, and you don't get work for a little bit. So yeah, totally, it's extremely important. And if you don't do that, if you stay within an organisation and just try and follow the route, you know, you could get made redundant when you're 36 and you lose your job, and you are so embedded into that organisation that you break down and can't kind of sustain yourself.
Mm. So are you having fun?
Am I having fun?
Yeah.
Most definitely, yeah.
But I mean right this moment. I mean, you know.
Yeah, no, I'm having fun right at this moment, apart from I drank probably too much water and I need to take a wee-wee. But aside from that, yeah, I mean, life is good. It's a good life. It's a hard life. It's, as I said, it's one of those things where it's insanely pressurised. I'm going to Pakistan and Sudan in 8 days, and I need to arrange so many things. And I'm going alone and meeting people out there. And like, so it can be a bit scary and daunting sometimes. But then again, it's like, that's the life. Why else would I want to live another way? The things you want to do, you want life to be a bit uncomfortable. But then I suppose journalism in a way is, it's beautiful in retrospect. When you look back on everything, it's amazing. At the time, it's not massively enjoyable, because it's like so many deadlines, everyone's pressurizing you have so much competition, people are kind of, you know, fighting to do what you're doing. But then when you look back at all the things that you've done, and especially me, because I make videos and documentaries, I can look back actually visually at the things that I've made, and it's just beautiful to be able to like see these sections of my life, and I can remember these things. So yeah, I'm definitely having fun. It's a good
thing. See if we can get some questions from the audience. Any questions from the audience?
Hi, so I have just finished my degree. So what would you advise? I have different experiences.
Congratulations.
And my degree is journalism and media. And I would like to, I mean, I like a bit of everything in terms of media. I would just like to start from something. And I like the creative part more than research part. So, I mean, I know, like, as you said, you make, like, videos and, like, documentaries and these kind of things. But, like, what would you advise to do? I have experience and these kind of things, but how can I mean, it's quite hard to find a job, of course. And, like, I'm not from here, as you can hear. So what would you advise to do, like, I mean, as you said, like, you need to be, like, determined, you need to be strong and everything, but these are just things that people say, like, on an actual thing, except for sending, like, I think I've sent, like, 60 applications. What else should I do?
Yeah, I mean, they're not things that people say, they are genuine things that you need to do, but it's less so. I suppose what you need to do is you need to think differently to everyone else. Like, what can you do that not everybody else is doing? Because everyone will send loads of applications, and why would you be chosen over someone else? So I'd say what you need to do is you need to make some of the things that you want to make, so you have an example of work that you can back up with what you're saying. So you can say to somebody, I want to work for you because I'm interested in this. Here's an example of me doing it to show you how good I am at doing it. Now give me a job. And that is, like, honestly, it's not just talk. If you actually have things to back up what you say, the chance of you being employed is just a million times more. As I said, at the moment, I'm trying to hire some cameramen in kind of Pakistan and Sudan and different places. And the ones that I'm hiring are the ones, it doesn't even matter how much experience they've had. It's more so they send me a showreel that is really good. And that sets them so far apart from everyone else, because you can actually see what they do, and you know that what they're saying is true. And also, it's the kind of proactivity to do it. Who would you rather employ? The person who says that they'll do it, or the person who can show you that they have done it 10 times without anybody paying them to do it, because they enjoy it so much? So if I was you, I would just do something, get some work. What specifically do you want to do? You said you don't like the research part, you like the creativity part?
Yeah, I'm more for like magazine editorial, like, you know, something like Time Out. So something like events, entertainment, these kind of things. So I'm not for like broadcast or like breaking news.
Yeah, you know? I mean, it's funny because in a way documentary is easier to get, it's not easier to get into, but it's easier to have an exact kind of product to sell, because if I make a really good documentary, I can use that. I mean, you just have to write these articles that you want, or you need to, if you want to get into the design part of it, you need to design examples of magazines that you like, because you just need the work to back up what you say. But yeah, as I said, I mean, it's because if you want to make videos, there's a reasonably easy route. It doesn't mean you're going to get a job, but you can just make, you can work on a documentary on the topic that you want. You can do it as best as you can, then you can put it on YouTube and try and show people it, and you can try and get as many views as possible. Yeah. I suppose, do you have a blog? You do? Do you write on that blog consistently?
Not as much as I should, but...
Yeah, I mean, and do you cover the stories?
I mean, if you Google my name, you can find different publications, which is good.
That's good, yeah. Yes, I mean, I suppose what you want to do is, because I remember when I first started, I wrote, like, articles for the Telegraph and stuff, but there were articles on, like, the amount of Alco Pops being sold in shops. I mean, that's not going to get me anywhere. No one cares about me writing about Alco Pops. That was just because I worked as on work experience and wrote this terrible article. So what you really want is, you kind of want the ideal example of what you want to do. So it'll be any topic of your choice. Remember, I did one on like national service in Iran, because as I said, I was interested in Iran at the time, and I found the guy who's being forced to go through national service when he wanted to move abroad. But in Iran, you can't move abroad unless you've done national service, because you can't get a passport. So no one paid me to do that, but that example was a prime example of something I would like to write. So it's just like getting something that you would like to do and writing the exact examples of the things you would like to do, as opposed to, because if someone searches your name on Google and finds a story about Alco Pops, they're not going to employ you, because it's just so boring that it's just like, who cares, it's freaking Alco Pops. So just try and like kind of fill your name on the internet with the things that you want to do.
How about when we go to interviews? I mean, except for the motivation, but what else do you think?
What
I
you
like
mean?
These examples. Like,
how to interview people?
No, the other way around. Like,
oh, what to say
not
to
like
them?
Not like a job interview, I mean.
What to say to them?
Yeah, like your first job interview, like the first job that you got. Like,
I mean, it's hard, isn't it? Because
it's very competitive.
It is very competitive, and that's like the nature of a job interview. What I'd say is try and avoid job interviews at all costs. meet people elsewhere. Try and always go through the sneaky route. That's the kind of best way. The best way to get a job is to become friends with people. I mean, that's just the truth. And it's not even nepotism. It's just more so people like to work with the people that they
networking.
Know. Yeah, it is networking. It's true. I mean, because as I said, it's just trying to narrow it's just kind of to broaden the chances that you're going to get a job and narrow the competition. So if you go to a job interview that has 400 people applying for that one job, there's going to be 400 people going for an interview that day. If you bump into the person who is actually doing the interview in the pub accidentally and spend 2 hours with them, they will remember you, because the truth is that the people who choose these jobs, the majority of the time, they're just like, oh, I just need somebody to do this. I'll just choose the first person that I can remember from my head. So you have to be the person that they remember. And the way you do that, in my opinion, is to do something reasonably outrageous, which is like accidentally.
It's interesting you say that, because of course here we've got students who are 17 and just sort of starting to reach out beyond school and college and to the outside world. And actually, they can start building networks now, even though they might not think about it as building a network. Actually, when they get somebody's email and somebody's telephone number, that's a contact. And that person will have their own network.
Yeah.
And the next, and you start to build up a network pretty quickly. Yeah. You know, but I'll tell you, if you start at 17, by the time you're 21, you can have a pretty comprehensive network.
And as I said, what you want to do is you want to do something out of the ordinary. And something out of the ordinary is quite simple when you're 17, because you're 17. Being purely your age is something that is out of the ordinary, because you're applying. Like, people email me and say, you know, I saw you made this film, can I come and work on the next one with you? And they're like 16.
Right.
And it's like, oh, what the hell? I was playing like video games in my undies when I was 16. And you're emailing me. I still do that now, but I was, you know, you're
too much information.
Yeah, sorry, I'm sorry. Yeah, but now, but they're emailing you, and that's like, if they were to email me in like 5 years' time, it would probably, you know, we all use the same emails. It's probably still going to have like Gmail in 5 years. It's probably going to group together with that same email, and I'll realize that this person for 5 years has been, and that's impressive. It's just like, what makes you different? Because especially in a career like journalism, you want somebody who is like, it's like do or die. They will just carry on. And they won't moan. They will just do stuff. So the people who are like trying to get it from such an early age, yeah, totally. Get into it. No matter what career you want, just get in touch with the people that you like now. And yeah, start speaking to them.
Benjamin, listen, it's been great having you here. It's always great having an award-winning journalist on the platform of broadcasting today. It's really impressive that you've given up your time, and your track record speaks for itself, that if you want to get involved, pick up a camera. If you want to get involved, go and meet people. If you want to get involved, take your university education seriously, but make sure it fits what it is that you want to do. So can we give Benjamin a round of applause? Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Thank you.